Hey Potters, welcome to episode 174 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Woo! We survived AnimeFest!
I don't know what that was. It was the sound of exhaustion.
That is about how we both feel right now.
Exhaustion and aging.
Yes, it sucks growing older, you guys. It really does. But at any rate, we are back from Anime Fest, which was this past weekend.
Yes.
We managed to be there for 3 of the 4 days. Unfortunately, we couldn't make it for all 4 days. So we will have a bit of a review for you guys. I believe you're the only one who's going to have cosplay updates this time, though, because mad convention prep.
Yeah, it's mostly convention prep, but my convention prep was also cosplay updates, so it kind of works really well together. Yay. So this has been my cosplay update. Is I finished the garment that I made for Anime Fest. This is a Gaijinka of the King Slime from the Dragon Quest series. This lovely lady actually correctly identified me. Funny enough, she was my judge's choice winner. I didn't expect that to happen. She's a huge Dragon Quest fan, so that made me super happy. And she got a plushie slime for me because of that. Yay. But this is my dress. This was a concept that I came up with a couple of weeks ago. And I was like, you know what? I really just want to make something fun and breathable, especially in Texas weather and with how hot and humid it was this weekend, wherever we were walking. It was like, I just want something that's easy, a lot of fun, a lot of color, and just something completely different for myself. And I came up with this cool concept. I was really happy with how it turned out. This was my first time actually wearing the whole piece together, and I had like 10 minutes to throw it on my body because we got out of judging really late. So the makeup is not quite what I want it to be. The hair is not quite what I want it, but that's okay. It was still a lot of fun to wear. I got a lot of compliments on it. Probably the coolest thing is that huge petticoat that I was making, which was like 28.55 yards of ruffles that you cannot see because it's all covered and it's just sad. But yeah, that's the finished product. Really happy with it. It's already been packed up and it's in the closets. I'm going to try and get a professional photo shoot out of it because it's more of a fun fashion-y thing instead of a cosplay thing. And I think that'll be a load of fun to do. I just don't know when or where. We'll figure that out eventually. Maybe when it's a little bit cooler outside so I really won't sweat. Because again, petticoat, not so great. But yeah, there you go. There's my cosplay updates. Pretty straightforward. Project done.
It's always good to have cosplay for multiple seasons and multiple weather, multiple climates. There we go.
Yes, very much so.
Because I will tell you that it was in the upper 90s outside during the weekend while we were at the convention. It was warmer than that in some of the hallways.
And AC what?
Well, to be fair, the AC was working and it was keeping up as well as could be expected, given the mass volume of people that were in the hotel. But I did feel bad for some of the people that were in very full cosplays or had full body makeup on. You could always hear the comments as you were walking down the hall, and people are like, I'm sweating everywhere. Like, yeah. And then it poured buckets of rain right afterwards.
Which that was really strange. It started raining and I didn't even hear it. And I just kind of looked outside and I was like, oh, it's raining. Okay. Wasn't expecting that.
Uh-huh.
Which just means more humidity. Yay. Ew. Thanks, Texas.
All right. So let's go ahead and get into our review of AFest, as this may take a little bit of time. Because there was a lot of AFest.
It was a lot. It's for a convention that's very casual and relaxing. It's basically the chill out con every year. There was still a lot of stuff going on and there was a lot of cosplaying to be had.
Yes. Which was one of the good things about the con. And I don't mean that to say like there are only a few good things. No. That's not what I mean. It's included in the list, which there's a decent sized list of good things about AFest this year. Pardon me. So, you know, first things first, yes, there was a bunch of cosplay.
Oh, yes.
And people were very willing and friendly to have their photos taken. They were prepared with poses. even the people who were nervous were pretty game to try it. And that makes me very proud, you know, as a cosplayer, that people are confident enough to allow us to take their photo, because you guys should know that you can always say no. You can always refuse if somebody asks to take your picture or video of you. The second good thing I found is that everybody seemed to very much enjoy themselves this year. And it's not just in the social media posts like, hey, I had a great time. You could actually see it on people's faces. You could hear it in the hallways. You could see it in the activities people were doing. They were really enjoying networking, meeting new people, which you can also hear in the hallways. You can hear people introducing themselves that didn't know each other before. And just the smiles and the glee on everyone's face, despite the heat and the mass numbers of people crowding the hallways. It was fun. And that's one of the great things about AFest, is it's a fun convention.
It's the type of convention you want to go to hang out with your friends, to meet new people, to people watch, which I know is something that we both love to do. And you just get general excitement in hanging out with people who like the same things that you do. You're like, oh, you're a Legend of Zelda fan? Cool, so am I. Let's go talk about it. And then let's play a game afterwards. Let's do it.
Yep. Another good thing is that registration moved very quickly. Even when there were really long lines, within probably a good 15 minutes when you came back, that line was much shorter. They were very efficient this year. And for the most part, I will give AnimeFest mad props for their signage. Very large signs, easy to read from a distance. Everything was well marked. For the most part, there were a couple of hiccups. A couple of the panel rooms didn't get their signs until late. And unfortunately, when you go to the booths that were on the second floor for registration and such, there were booths on the side that you didn't necessarily notice unless you physically walked over there, because from the front, it just looked like the ends of the registration booths that were facing you.
Yeah, it looked like just one line.
Right, it didn't look like separate booths, but there were separate booths,
yeah.
And those were not labeled at all with signs, which we needed to go to one of those booths, so it would be really helpful next year. I know that they put up handwritten signs, so they did make an effort. Just for next year, perhaps, it would help to have signs for those booths too. Because a lot of people had to go. Yeah.
Because handwritten signs can only go so far. When you're standing 100 feet away, you can't see in pencil what this thing is.
Right. Or even in Sharpie, to an extent. You need large, friendly block letters.
Right.
Please. We mean all of this as constructive criticism, as always. We're not bashing the con whatsoever. We had a great time. These are things we would like them to improve. Another fantastic thing that they did this year that I don't remember them doing last year was to have large LED schedule boards.
Oh, yeah.
Those were really helpful. When you needed to see where something was, when something was, the boards constantly updated. I actually watched them cycle. They were easy to read, even from a decent distance away. And they were placed in good locations for the most part. And I really appreciated that, because they did not, unfortunately, and this is one of the bad things, they did not have paper copies of the schedule at the con. They wanted you to download their app, which is all fine and good unless you don't have a smartphone or if you don't want to install the app on the smartphone for whatever reason. In which case, you had no schedule, which made things a little hard. We ended up jotting down our schedule before we left, just so that we would know when and where things were supposed to be.
Another thing that I did notice in the very few panels that I could sit in on, because I was pretty much busy all the weekend with cosplay contest stuff, it did definitely seem like tech support was really on the ball this year. AV was just like there. They were ready to go. They had everything set up for all the panelists. That part of the department has always seemed to run really, really smoothly at AFest, even in the years when I was a panelist and we had some hiccups. They were always really on top of it and trying to do their best to help out the panelists. So AV team, is always top notch every year, and they seem to just get better. They've learned from the past, and they just keep improving even as technology goes up.
Two other good things I wanted to call out kudos on. And this first one, there seems to be a little controversy over, but I'm only speaking from my own personal experience. There were numerous volunteers that were happy to help you.
Yeah, definitely.
There was no shortage of volunteers that I could see. There were people in the AnimeFest vests everywhere I looked. And I didn't have any problems getting help from any one of them. They were very friendly. They were punctual. They found out what I needed to know. And they didn't, you know, give a speech. They were just very concise.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate that. That's really well done on their part.
They were very in the know of what was going on. I didn't have to ask 20 different people to figure out where the press booth was. I just had to ask one person, and they knew exactly where I needed to go. And that's probably the first time that's ever happened to me, because usually we end up having to go in circles to find press.
That was one of the missing signs.
Yeah. Hint, hint, wink, wink.
But the other thing that I wanted to note, lastly, before we discuss some of the other things, is the dealer's den was well set up. There was very ample room set up for each individual booth, as far as I could tell. And there were wide aisles, which is a very good thing, unfortunately, when we compare it to the artist alley later. But it made it much easier to move around so that people could browse booths and not completely impede the walkway. That was really helpful. There were still a ton of people in the dealer's room, but traffic actually flowed around the dealer's room. And there were a really good variety of merch that people were offering. It wasn't all the same thing. It wasn't all the same series. There were lots of things that you could choose from. Everything from makeup to art, plushies, t-shirts, figurines, Funko Pops, jewelry of all kinds. Even Kinokuniya, the bookstore, had a booth there. And that was really cool. So kudos to the dealer's den. Really well done.
I will say that one thing that I've been looking forward to now for the past couple of AnimeFest has been the Artist Alley itself, because they have such a wide variety of unique artists there. You can see just about everything and anything, and pretty much all different types of fandoms too. If you're looking for something in particular, something specific for a weird random anime series that you think, oh, nobody will have this, it's probably in the AnimeFest Artist Alley. And that's just so cool that you don't have to hunt to find a really unique item that's just for you right there. So I really have a blast walking through there, just looking at the wares. And I actually picked up quite a few things this year that I didn't expect I would. Got some really cute keychains, which I'm really happy about, too. So yeah, I love the variety of the Artist Alley. They seem to always do a great job there.
One of the downsides to the Artist Alley, with all of that choice downstairs, meant a ton of artists, and the aisles were very slim.
Yeah, it gets packed really quickly, and until they start expanding it or even just moving autographs to another location, if they're there at max capacity, they got to find a way to expand or start cutting out artists, unfortunately.
Basically, it was three people wide, so if you had people browsing on either side of you at the booths, only one person could fit between them, which meant traffic didn't flow both ways anymore. And that ended up being a problem several times as we were trying to get in and out to take photos of cosplayers out of the way of the booths so that we didn't impede traffic, because we were, you know, trying to be good attendees and good press. And for the most part, we were able to do that, just it got a little difficult to maneuver sometimes with the boots. But all in all, otherwise, it seemed to be very well run with good choices. Speaking of press, we did not participate in the interviews simply because we are a niche outlet. We don't necessarily cover those other things on a regular basis, so we can't really speak to whether or not the new interview process worked. So I will set that portion aside.
We should probably point out that at AnimeFest, they don't typically have like cosplay guests that are there. They have their own booths, you know, that they're like special promos. They have cosplayers come to help judge the contest, and that's it. So we don't really take the time to interview the guests that are brought in from AnimeFest because they're usually voice actors or they work on anime shows. It's not really cosplayers. So we should probably put that out there.
Right. We intend no disrespect. It's simply not our niche.
Mm. If Yaya Han were to be a guest, then yes, we would be like, we would like to talk to her and interview her again because she's awesome. Right. But until that happens, that's not going to be our thing.
I did want to mention that press was very, communicative during the convention. Mm-hmm. I did notice emails coming through from them. The only downside to that is that if you didn't check your email during the con, you didn't see it. Which made things a little difficult whenever schedules changed, because I noticed late after the fact that another interview session was added. It's like, oh, I didn't see this until much, much later.
Which, way too late. It's like, eh.
Yeah.
And a lot of the details came to us, unfortunately, a little too close to the convention, so we couldn't really plan things out as nicely as we could have. So it was just like, ooh, cutting it close, guys.
Right. But other than that, I didn't have, you know, really any issues with it to speak of.
It was pretty smooth and streamlined. It was probably the fastest that we've ever gotten our badges before.
Well, your badges. My badges somehow disappeared.
Yours magically vanished, which I don't understand how that happens, but whatever.
But props to HQ for very quickly remedying that.
Right?
Kudos to them. Good job.
They were on top of it.
They really were. Like, no sarcasm. They were very efficient. And they were very friendly, too. What else? One of the downsides that I think they're really going to have to remedy next year is the sheer volume of people on Saturday. Not just downstairs in the artist alley, but just in the hotel in general. It eventually got to what for me was a breaking point, because I am, you know, not very comfortable in such large, confined groups of people. Because the hotel only has so much space for you to move around. And Saturday afternoon, those hallways were full of people. You could not move around. You just kind of ended up having to be gently pushed along by the stream of traffic. You just kind of had to go with the flow to get anywhere.
Literally, we went with the flow just to kind of move around.
Because we did film panels for you guys. And so we had to get from panel room to panel room, and we just kind of went like a stick in the stream, just kind of went.
Mm-hmm. It still was not as bad as when Akon was at that hotel. It's still lighter than that, because that was like sardine can. You could not move. This, you could still at least move and maneuver. They're not at that level yet, but I think that they need to figure out a balance. And that may just be that they need to shift some content around so that the traffic flow will be a little bit better organized. Maybe more people will be in this section when this event's going on. I don't know. I think a lot of it is just different types of planning that they need to do next year.
Yes, and I have every confidence that they will take that into account. Speaking of planning, construction.
That's not their fault.
No. I am not laying blame. Like, again, this is all constructive. We are not bashing anybody. I am not laying blame whatsoever. However, I feel it does need to be pointed out that parking aside, I know that they had nothing to do with the parking. That wasn't where I was going with this. The construction in the hotel, the back area of the hotel where there used to be a glass railing that led down to an atrium downstairs, and then you had the theater in back. Well, that area, there's no more glass railing. There are walls. It's all been plastered over. And in that area where there used to be glass walls is now a mini bar. And if you didn't know something was behind the bar, that the hallway kept going, you wouldn't have known to look back there at all. I think potentially they could have done a little bit additional with the signing to let them know that one of the workshop rooms, one of the main panel rooms, was back down that hallway and that you had to keep going because unless you literally walked up to it, you didn't see the hallway in the back. And that's mostly what I was going for with the construction, is just because that was so different, everything looked so different, I didn't think to walk back there until much, much later.
Yeah, this is where we point out that the Sheraton, it was under construction. The entire first floor is under construction. And we didn't know about this, and I don't think AFest knew about this until very recently, like within the last week and a half, 2 weeks. Because we got an email from the hotel directly, and then the next day AnimeFest was like, so there's construction going on, guys. Guess what?
made parking very difficult.
It wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. My normal parking location was still open, and I was like, yay, cool. So I didn't have too much trouble with it. But I could see why some people were a little, you know, taken aback by it. Some of the parking spots that used to be next to the hotel are now being turned into green spaces, which is not a bad thing. Green spaces are great. However, parking is already very limited in downtown Dallas, and it's at a premium. So taking away more parking is just that much more aggravating. So it's like, great, thank you, appreciate it. Again, not the convention's fault. This is the city plus the hotel. They're doing, it's part of a renovation project. Basically, if you live in Texas, everything is under construction. And it's just part of life. At all times, 24/7. It's life here. That's how it goes. So of course, it was going to happen during AFest weekend. Go fake.
So yes.
That was a thing.
That was a thing. Thankfully, it did not impede the food trucks.
No, it did not. Food trucks were there. I was a happy camper.
Yes. I know that AFest doesn't have a listing of the food trucks or necessarily of the food that would be there. That is something that I would recommend to them for future improvement, particularly for those of us with dietary needs, because it really helps us plan like how much food we need to bring and how much food we can plan on purchasing while there. But thankfully, there were a couple of different food trucks. There was Chick-fil-A downstairs, and the hotel brought back their own table offering, where they had a small table set up with various things, sandwiches, pizza, hot dogs, drinks, cookies, chips, that sort of thing. So at least there was a good amount of food. Oh, also a Bubblicious tea.
Of course.
Had a table set up this year, which was different from last year. So there were plenty of things to choose from in addition to the usual ordering in food, or if you wanted to walk down the street to a few of the establishments. And of course, the plaza next door also had some food, which has also changed from last year, I found. The plaza staff, very accommodating. No problems whatsoever. And I didn't see any problems either. Like, not just with us, but just watching other people interact. The business folks didn't seem taken aback by the people with the random party wigs. Everything just seemed very normal. And, you know, that's fantastic. We don't want to be a disruption,
right?
We just want to have fun and not, you know, freak people out.
Well, we can freak them out, but not that badly.
Yep. So we are showing a few pictures from AFest so that you can see the cosplayers and the very efficient lines that were in registration. I'm so happy that that went well.
I'm glad it did. I think since they made that move to start mailing out their badges, it's made it much more streamlined, much more efficient. And they even have a good system for those who didn't get their badges in the mail. It's like, hey, bring this with you. We'll get you taken care of, which is so nice to see.
Mm-hmm.
Why waste your time in line when you can go run around and enjoy the convention?
And for the most part, actually entirely, For the entire part, everyone was very well behaved.
Yeah.
And And I don't mean that in any sort of derogatory manner. It's that some years there have been people that are a little more rambunctious, run around glomping people, stalking. There are various incidents that happen. Everything seemed to go really well this year. I didn't see any random incidents. I didn't see anything out of the ordinary. Not to say it didn't happen, just that I didn't see it. At least as far as I could see, everything went really well. I didn't even notice any programming glitches, honestly. I didn't notice any canceled panels. I didn't notice any panels that were empty. There were always people in every room, as far as I could tell, as long as the room was open, obviously.
Should we talk about the panels themselves?
Yes.
So I think for both Amber and I, we were a little disappointed by the lack of cosplay panels that were available. And I get it. AnimeFest is set up in a way that people submit their panels and they are judged on by a small panelist team with AFest, as well as, you know, voted on by popularity to see which ones get approved or which ones do not. And the judges for AFest have, you know, final say of, yes, this is what will go on to the schedule. It just felt like this year there weren't as many of them available, or it was all the same content that we keep seeing year after year. It's getting kind of stale and a little bit more difficult to want to go see those panels.
It's not that we don't like the 101 panels. 101 panels are very needed still, because there are still tons of people who are entering the cosplay community. But at the same time, a lot of these, like you said, have been presented before,
mm-hmm.
whether at AFest or at other local cons. We've filmed several of them.
Yes.
And you can see a lot of them on YouTube now. And we would really love to see a mix of content, not just the 101, but also content for cosplayers who have, you know, been around for a few years, who would like to see something more, take it to the next level, see some new techniques and new perspectives that we haven't seen before. Because we really do want to learn from each other. And I know that part of that is that people have to actually offer the panels. So it's possible that there weren't as many offered this year, which is fine. Just we would like to recommend that for improvement in the future.
It may be one of those that as the management chain keeps changing and updating and growing, that they realize, hey, maybe we do need to bring in cosplay guests to help teach some of these niche panels and get more interest in our local community.
Right.
I don't know. But yeah, the offerings this year were fine. And AFest does typically have a lot of first-time or new cosplayers. I mean, heck, for the cosplay contest, we had so many people enter who say, yeah, this is my first time entering, or this is my first cosplay ever. So it definitely makes sense for AFest to have a lot of those 101, you know, beginner panels. Mm-hmm. But they also have a lot of master-level cosplayers who still want to learn more. So it's good to offer more of that content.
Mm-hmm. And also, for those panelists that did present at AFest, bravo to you for getting
yes.
up in front of people and presenting. You could tell that there were panelists for whom this was probably their first time. And I would really like to applaud them, because it takes courage to get up and present in front of a room of people, whether it's a room of two people or 200. It's not easy. And I would highly encourage them to come back and do it again. And for those who are return panelists, thank you. Thank you for keeping the tradition going, and we hope that you guys return as well. The panel lines moved smoothly. It was very quick and easy to get into the panel rooms. The scanner seemed to work very well this year. My only nitpick with the panels, okay, I have two nitpicks. One was the panel room layout.
Mm-hmm.
Having panels 1, 2, and 3 downstairs, and then 4 and 5 in another part of the center, and then 6 in another part of the center, and then the workshop rooms in other parts of the center, made it a little difficult to find everything and to keep things consistent so that if you wanted to attend panels that were back to back or next to each other, if they were on opposite sides, you weren't going to make it, especially with all the traffic. So I do kind of miss the layout that was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 back in the day that were all in that one area. It made things really easy.
Right.
Now, granted, that may possibly just be a complaint on my part, but that's just my own personal quibble. But the other is that some of the panel rooms that were across from the elevators, the lines came out into the hallway, and that made it really hard to get around. It also made it difficult to tell what panel rooms the lines were for.
Right.
And it's like, for the other rooms downstairs, it worked great because there was an overflow area. But for the panel rooms that were upstairs in the hotel, you ran into the elevator line, which then ran into the hallway, which then created an even more crowded situation. So if there's any way that that can be, maybe the lines pointed the other direction instead of into the hallway, that might help. I don't know. It's a logistics thing, and that's not my cup of tea. I wouldn't even really know beyond that how to recommend fixing it.
Right.
It just caused crowding problems is all. But I'm sure they know and they'll fix it. I can't think of anything else specifically offhand that is cosplay specific. Did you want to talk about the contest?
I was about to say, do you want me to talk about the contest?
Yes, please.
Okay, cool. I can do that. So I was a guest judge again for the contest this year. At the contest itself, it seemed to run pretty smoothly. I definitely enjoyed the atmosphere. The MCs always do a good job, and they have a great time riling up the crowd, getting the cosplayers excited. As I mentioned beforehand, we had a lot of first-time cosplayers in the contest this year, and they were so overjoyed just to be involved and to be on the stage and to have people see their costumes. And that type of love for cosplay is just so infectious. It just made me sit there and go, yeah, this is why I cosplay, because I like being that person who's just so happy just to dress up as their favorite character. And I don't care if anybody knows who I am. It's just fun, and it's so great. And it was a blast to have myself and the other judges cheering everybody on as they got on the stage. We actually had little pom-poms with us. We became Team Pom-Pom. Felt like cosplay moms and dads just being like, yes, we are so proud of you. Yay. It was a blast. For the contest itself, it seemed to run pretty smoothly. For the halftime show, what they decided to do was, instead of having a separate skit contest, there were not many skit entries this year. They made the skits the halftime show. So that's what kind of set in and took the time while we were deliberating. And they also announced the hall awards, as well as had a slideshow of all the hall play entries. So that was really nice too. So that way people could actually see what they were missing out on by not being in the hall contest. And I was like, okay, cool. We should do more of that. That's great. Probably the biggest concern I had with the event itself was the sound issues. The music that they were playing this year was so overpowering. It was a little difficult to hear the MCs at times. And I think that was pretty prevalent throughout the area, because on their live stream, as well as the upload that they have of the contest itself, you could tell that there were sound issues. You could tell that the music was just way too loud. And they tried to turn up the mics to compensate for that. And unfortunately, you got feedback going on. You got some really booming voices going through, because the MCs in general are very good at projecting their voices. They don't need a whole lot of microphone power. And when you give them too much microphone power, it's just like, okay, too much. Ears can't handle it. So where I was sitting, it was a lot of music, not a whole lot of judges, and it was really difficult to hear them. So most of the time, I have no idea what they are saying, and I felt really bad because they're good MCs. I don't think some of their jokes landed because we couldn't hear them, and I felt horrible. That was probably my biggest concern. The contest did start a little late, but that was because pre-judging ran late. They were trying out a new system this year, so stuff happens. It's okay. We had plenty of entries, lots of really cool costumes. AFest cosplayers always amaze me, not just with their talent, but with their creativity and what people will do to make their costumes and the things that they tear apart. Like one family like took apart multiple other costumes to make their group fairy tale outfits. And I would, and it just blows my mind that people are able to be so creative and so resourceful and just use the materials that they have in front of them to make all these beautiful, amazing things. So yeah, I mean, and just in general, it was a fun contest. Everything ran fairly smoothly, just sound issues in general, but that's something that they can review and they can fix for next year. That's an easy, straightforward fix, not a big deal. And actually the contest itself, I think we were done by like 8:30, 8:45. So it was only an hour and a half. We were not in there for very long. It could have been way worse, and we've done so much longer events. So yeah, it was fun. I enjoyed it. I think everybody in the audience enjoyed it. A lot of people were still there when we were announcing the award. So that's a good thing too, because usually you have that dead time that after the runway, people start filing out. A lot of people were still in the audience at the halfway point. So that's good.
So all in all,
it was good.
Thumbs up for AFest.
Yeah.
They did a good job overall. There were just like little nitpicky things that we would like them to address, but they're not really like hard negatives. They're little things, because overall everything ran beautifully. It was a fun con.
It was a fun con. They're steadily getting back into the old school AFest. And I don't mean that in like in a negative way. I mean that in a really good way, because it's one of the things that brought me into cosplaying and the convention scene was old school AFest. It was just chill hangout con, and I like chill hangout con. I want more of that.
But, you know, there were tables everywhere for people to hang out.
Yes.
Upstairs and downstairs.
Big thumbs up. We need more of those, please. And thank you for not yelling at us for plopping our butts along the wall so we could eat real quick. Like, we appreciate that so much. You have no idea.
They ran out of space.
Which was going to happen.
The food area that they had set up in front of the hotel in Chick-fil-A and Bubblicious, there just wasn't enough room. But that's okay. They still tried really hard. They made a good effort.
They're one of the few conventions that actually thinks about, oh, hey, maybe we should give these people table space. It's like, yeah, that would be awesome, because we would like to sit down every now and then in our crazy-ass 6-inch heels. That'd be lovely.
Or even just in regular shoes. You still get tired walking around, you know, 7 to 10 miles per day. And sometimes you just need a break. Yeah. Hydrate. All the water stations, as far as I could tell, were kept full.
Right.
They did run out of cups very quickly.
But not shocking.
Yes. And I didn't hear about any issues with the water stations, so that was good. Yeah.
Okay. All in all, fun con.
Good on them. Hopefully things will be even better next year.
Yeah.
And for all of the cosplayers whose photo we took, your photos will be on the website. You may view them at your leisure. And thank you to everybody who allowed us, again, to take their picture. All right. Anything else?
That's all I got.
All right. Well, we will call an end to this episode 174 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. We invite you guys to interact with us. Let us know how your AFest was or any other conventions you were attending this weekend on any of our social media, which you can find here.
Apparently, there are 31 conventions going on in the U.S. this weekend. So, wow. Have fun with that.
And of course, we invite you guys to interact with us via email, podcast@cospod.org. Otherwise, we will wish you guys happy cosplaying. We will see you guys next episode. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye, guys.